Yeah, the fact that we have this spectral theorem, which gives us a spectral measure, and that we have the possibility of integrating a big class of functions with respect to a spectral measure, gives us in the end the possibility of defining very general functions of self-adjoint operators. And so this is maybe the next theorem, also a main theorem in this context, which usually goes under the name of functional calculus for operators. Huh? I mean, the goal there is to define functions of operators. And for our self-adjoint operators, we can do this in a very general sense, namely, we can define measurable functions of the operators. So, namely, let T be our self-adjoint operator, a self-adjoint operator on our Hilbert space, and of course, it can be an unbounded operator. By the spectral theorem, we know that it has a spectral decomposition. So we can write it in the form of the spectral decomposition. So we have a resolution of identity or a projection-valued measure such that we can write T as the integral over lambda dE lambda. So for a given T, we get a uniquely determined spectral resolution or a projection-valued measure, and if we have such a measure, we can define functions, we can define integrals over many functions. The operator T is given as an integral over the function f of lambda is equal to lambda, but now, of course, we can put here many arbitrary, almost arbitrary functions, and this means we get what we then would call the corresponding function of the operator. So that's what we can do here. So this means for each measurable function, let's say f from R to C, so it should be defined on R, but a priori it can take on complex values. Then there exists an operator. There exists an operator, which we get by integrating here over f of lambda instead of just lambda. And of course, this operator we are going then to call f of t, or denote it by f of t. So we get an operator which we denote by f of t. And this is given or defined as integrating the function f with respect to our spectral resolution. And maybe let me recall a few of basic properties of this. I mean, we had this general statement which says whenever I have a spectral resolution, I can do integrals like this. And now the only point is that the spectral resolution is now the one which comes from our operator T. So what I get if I'm integrating this function here should be considered as the corresponding function of T. Yeah, but let me recall maybe two things essentially, namely what is the domain. So this operator will be in general an unbounded operator, so it has a domain which doesn't have to be everything, and the domain of this as of f of t are those elements in the Hilbert space for which the integral over the function the absolute value of f squared integrated with respect to dx e lambda x. This guy is less than infinity. And this here is an ordinary, this here is an ordinary Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral. So this is just a real number here, because this guy here, this is really the distribution function of an ordinary measure. And so we can use it for Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral. Good. So that's the domain. And how is the operator defined? It is defined by giving its inner products with arbitrary vectors, or let's say with vectors in the domain. So namely, we can say what is x, f of tx. And if we know all those guys for all x's in the domain, this means we know the operator. By polarization, we can have here x and y, and then we know it. And this is given by essentially, I mean, putting the axis here means we put the axis to this guy here, and then we are essentially back to a quantity like this. So namely, we say this is the same as f of lambda integrated with respect to the distribution function x e lambda x. Yeah, and this of course we require where it makes sense, no? Namely for x in the domain. So for all x in the domain of f of t, which means x's for which this guy here is finite. Yeah, okay, so this means we can define any measurable function on R of our operator. And of course, those functions of the operators behave now with respect to addition and multiplication as you expect. So in particular, if we have, let's say, two functions, then of course we can take the product of them, and then we can first apply for each of the functions, we can do this here and apply the functions to the operators and then multiply the operators, or we can first multiply the functions, so we get a new measurable function, and apply this to the operator. And of course this should be the same, but of course one has to be a little bit careful about the domain, because with unbounded operators, yeah, the domain, if I'm taking a product, is maybe not so clear. So let us maybe check what we get here. So if I have two functions, measurable functions, from R to C, let's say, and let us check what happens with the product. Of course, f times g is then just another measurable function. So we can take f, g, and f times g. We can apply all those functions to our operator, and we get three operators. And what is the relation between them? So then, then I'm saying that ft times gt, so I'm first taking my functions of the operator and multiply them, that this is, maybe you would expect it should be equal, but because of the domains, in general it will only be a subset, or let's say fg of t is an extension of this. So this means the domain on this side might a priori be smaller than on this side. But where they agree, where both are defined, then they are equal. And so what is actually the domain on this side? I mean, on this side it is clear what the domain is, according to this general definition. On this side here, so f of t, g of t, so what is this? So of course we take if I want to apply this to an x, first I apply g to x, so this means I must be in a domain of g of t. So this means this is in the domain of g of t, but then g of t maps this x to something, and then this something, this must be in the domain of f. So what I also need here is f of g times t, so that this makes sense. Yeah, so this domain here, so it must be in a domain of this function f of g of t, but then it must also be in a domain of g itself, so that I can apply this guy here to my function t. Because it can happen that f times g has a much better domain than g itself. So for example, g could be something like 1 over f, maybe the domain is not everything, but then f times 1 over f is the identity which has a domain everything. So this means on this side here, I must not just be in a domain of the composition, but I must first be in a domain of g for itself. Okay, so this means I have this intersection here. Good, but in principle it fits together as it should. So taking the product of a functions of an operator is more or less, up to these details about the domain, is the product of the operators where I apply the functions separately to the operator. Good, okay, so this is general, and maybe for us most interesting part is if I'm taking real-valued functions, or maybe before we do this, maybe let us check what does it mean if I take the adjoint of my operator. So for each function, I get an operator, And this operator, I can take the adjoint, and this of course should be another function of the operator, of the original operator t, and what should it be? Of course, I mean, taking the adjoint here should correspond here to taking the complex conjugation, because the adjoint of those guys doesn't change anything, because those are just orthogonal projections. So the star of E is just E itself. So I really should get the complex conjugate here, and that is really how it is. So, for measurable f, again, in full generality, we have that f of t, so f of t is a densely defined operator. So it's adjoint, is given by f bar of t. And this means in particular, if f bar is equal to f, which means f is real valued, then the adjoint of f of t is f of t itself, which means f of t is a self-adjoint operator. And that's the one in which we're interested. So that's the main important statement here. So in particular, if f is real valued, then this implies that f of t is self-adjoint. Good. Okay. And maybe let me make a few remarks on this functional calculus. So this is a very important frame or theorem, which tells us that we are able to take very general functions of our operators if the operator is self-adjoint. So it's really very, very special situation being self-adjoint. Then we can take many functions. Of course, there are more general or functional calculi for other operators, but then things are getting more complicated. Okay, and for self-adjoint one, self-adjoint is really a very nice class of operators for which we have a very strong theory. So namely, we can take any measurable function of them. So what we have here is a very general functional calculus. Okay, so note that this gives a very general functional calculus for self-adjoint operators. A very general functional for self-adjoint operators. And I mean, in the case of unbounded operators, even taking maybe the simplest functions, namely polynomials, is not a priori clear whether this works or not, because we have the problem with the domain. So I mean, namely, taking the product of unbounded operators is maybe a problem, and maybe which we already see here. So I mean, if you have two functions for which you know what g of t and what f of t is, then of course, I mean, in principle, you would like to define the product of them by multiplying the operators. Okay, but the point is g of t times f of t might not really be nicely defined, because the domain might be too small. But on the other hand, I mean, here, in this case, we have here an extension, so we know how we should make the domain here big enough so that it still makes sense. So because we define the domain of the product in a way which also guarantees that it is densely defined. Without this general frame, in general, if I'm multiplying two operators, each of them densely defined, the product might not be densely defined, because I mean, I apply the first operator. Okay, this can be defined on a dense subset, but then of course the range of this guy should be in the domain of the other operator, and the intersection between the two domains, the domain here and the range here, it can be very small. Okay, so this means even for polynomials, this gives a way of defining polynomials in our unbounded operators, which, if you want to define them directly, might not be so clear that this really works. So for unbounded operators, not even polynomials are a priori well defined. Since if you just, I mean, if you would want to say what is t squared of x applied to vector x, this is of course t of x, and then you must be sure that x is in the domain of t, but if you want to apply t again, then t of x should also be in the domain of t. So t should map the domain into itself, and this is usually not really given. So this thing here might not have a dense domain. Yeah, but if we do it like this, then we really get a domain which is dense. So we really know how to define this for a dense domain. Yeah, good. And maybe another remark is that now I can integrate, a big deal of functions. In particular, I can integrate characteristic functions for intervals, and then this really gives me what justifies to call this an operator valued measure or projection valued measure. So namely, I can now integrate measurable functions. So, and the basic measurable functions are characteristic functions of measurable sets. So let me do this. So take for f the characteristic function of a set B, where B is a Borel set, let's say a measurable set of R for Borel sets B in R. And then what we get then are, of course, if we are integrating this, we get operators, but actually those operators are now all projections and they are mutually orthogonal. And so this is really what one should call or calls a projection valued measure. So if you do this, we get then our projection valued measure, which maybe let me also call it mu sub t. Of course, it depends on t. And so what is this? So this measure is a map which sends a measurable set, a set B, to mu t of B, which is just the characteristic function of B applied to t, which by definition is integrating the characteristic function with respect to this e lambda here, which of course we are also calling projection valued measure, but this e lambda is actually the distribution function of our measure. And now I'm really writing it down for any set. I mean, a measure in its original sense really should be a function which assigns to each set, each measurable set, in a classical context a number, but here an operator, and the operator here is projection valued. So I'm integrating here over B d e lambda. And of course, it's appropriate to call this E of B instead of, I mean, I could write it like this, or maybe more in accordance with this notation here, I call it E of B. And this E of B, so for each measurable subset of R, I have an operator E of B, and this has which properties? So the following one. So with the following properties. So first of all, each of them is an orthogonal projection. So E of B is always an orthogonal projection for each b. So orthogonal projection means e of b squared is equal to e of b, and it's also the same as e of b star, so it's self-adjoint. Of course, those are projections, bounded operators, and what they do in the Hilbert space is, of course, they are projecting down to a subspace. Yeah, okay, then furthermore, if I take the extreme measurable subsets of R, so namely the empty set and all of R, I get, of course, the extreme projections, namely for the empty set, I'm projecting just onto zero, so this is the zero operator, and for R, I'm not projecting at all, or I'm projecting onto everything, so this is just the identity. So my measure here has the property that E of the empty set is the zero operator, and E of the full set is the identity operator, is one. And then if I take two sets and I'm projecting, let's say I take here a set B1 and I'm taking here a set B2, so I'm projecting first onto something corresponding to this set and then I'm projecting onto something corresponding to this set, so I take the product of the two guys, then this is the same as projecting just onto the intersection. So this is, I mean, this reflects the properties of the characteristic functions if I transfer them to the integral, because the product of two characteristic functions for two sets is just the characteristic function of the intersection of them. So this means I have here that E of B1 times E of B2, so this is the same as taking E of the intersection. And in particular, the EB1 and EB2 commute. Yeah, and then maybe the measure property, I mean, the measure should be additive or sigma additive. So if I take the measure of the disjoint union of sets, then it should be the sum of the corresponding measures. So here the same, if B is the disjoint union of, let's say, Bn, so this can be finite or countable set, so the dot here means I have a disjoint union, and then really the E of B is the sum of the Bn's, and of course if it's countable there is a limit involved, so I have to say in which topology does this converge, and it converges in a topology, I mean if I apply two vectors. So for each vector, EB of X is the sum over the n's of the EBn of X. So those are elements in the Hilbert space. This might be an infinite sum in the Hilbert space, but of course we take the convergence in the Hilbert space with respect to the norm in the Hilbert space. In this sense, we have this equality for all X in our Hilbert space. So it's not a convergence in the operator norm, because all those guys are projections, and projections cannot really converge to other projections. So I mean, characteristic functions can converge pointwise to other characteristic functions, but not in a uniform norm in general. So here it's the same. I have to do things pointwise. And again, this is just reflecting the fact that if I take a sum of characteristic functions corresponding to disjoint sets, then this is just the characteristic function of the union of the sets. Yeah, and I think that's all the property which I have here. And this really, I mean, this justifies to call the E lambda, which we had in the beginning, an operator valued or projection valued measure. And of course, proving the spectral theorem, of course, relies on really constructing this object here. So, I mean, I, of course, have presented things in a way that we have the spectral theorem, and the spectral theorem allows us to take characteristic functions of intervals and doing a very general functional calculus. But, of course, if you want to To prove the spectral theorem, you have to construct this operator-valued measure, and for this, essentially, you have to construct the functional calculus. So the proof goes the other way around. I mean, you have to define, let's say, maybe first continuous functions of your operators, and then maybe you have to go over to measurable functions, and then if you take the characteristic functions of intervals, this gives you exactly this E lambda. Okay, so I mean, what I have presented here as a consequence of the spectral theorem, of course, is the main, to prove that you have all these properties and these objects is the main part of the proof of the spectral theorem. But anyhow, I mean, it's if you have the spectral theorem, you have all those objects, and you have a very, very nice and consistent theory. And maybe a final remark, which I want to make, is actually about... Where does this spectral measure really live? So I mean, if you have a measure on the real line, then this measure usually has a support where it really puts all its mass. If you have Lebesgue measure, it's defined everywhere. If I take Lebesgue measure restricted to the interval 0 to 1, then it only lives on 0, 1. If you have discrete measures, then it only lives on the discrete points. And so here the question is actually where does this measure live on R? Is it defined everywhere or is it more specific? Because if I do integration, of course, here I'm saying I have to integrate over all of R, but actually, of course, in the end, you only have to integrate over the subset of R where really this measure puts mass. And so maybe we should think about this question, whether we can say more about this. Because this will also relate the whole thing with the spectrum of the operator. I mean, if as far as I have written it now, you don't see how the spectrum plays any role for doing those things. Okay, but of course the spectrum should be somehow related or should show up somewhere. So let us think a little bit about this. And so maybe for this. Maybe we should first think about what is actually the operator norm of such integrals. So, and those integrals, if you look what they really mean or what they are, of course, are essentially sums of increments of this function e, and e for some intervals are orthogonal projections. So what you have are limits of sums of linear combinations of orthogonal projections. And what is the sup of such an object, the operator norm? So note, let me just take, let's say I have measurable subsets of R, BIs, such that for different indices they are disjoint. So let's say BI and BJ is the empty set, if I is different from J, and then I'm looking on sums corresponding to such integrals. So namely, I'm looking on alpha I e of bi. So this would be the integrals where I have piecewise constant distribution functions, where I'm making jumps, or where I'm taking, let's say those are those integrals if I'm integrating over characteristic functions. So you can say this here, maybe I should write it down. So this is the integral over f dE lambda, where f is the sum of alpha I characteristic function of bi. So these are the type of integrals which I get for those specific functions. And so the question is what is the supremum norm? What is actually the norm of such an operator? So we have that this is this, and the norm of such an operator, alpha I e b I. So this is now a sum of those guys are orthogonal projections, so each of them is an orthogonal projection, but for different I's, they are also orthogonal to each other, and then I'm taking here coefficients. And so what is the norm of this operator? And if you yeah, think a little bit about this. You see that this is actually the maximum of those guys. So this is the maximum of the absolute value of the coefficients. So in principle, this is like if you have, I mean, if you write this here, let's say in a finite case as a matrix in a diagonal form, this is like a matrix where you have alphas on a diagonal, alpha 1 up to alpha n, and what is the norm, the operator norm of such a matrix, and this is the maximal absolute value of the alpha of the alphas on a diagonal. So you have the maximum of this, and of course, okay, under the condition that this e of bi here is really a projection which is not zero. If you have a zero here, then if this is the zero operator, then of course this alpha i will not play a role. So this means what we have here is the maximum of the alpha i's over the i's, but of course only over those for which e of bi is not zero. So this means only there where the e really puts some mass. Yeah, and now if you do the same for the continuous version, so for arbitrary integrals like this, then one can see, so in the same way, for the integrals, one has that the norm of the integral f of lambda, dE lambda, which in a sense is limit of such things, that this is given by the supremum of the f of lambdas. Of course, we have to take the absolute value of them. And then we take the supremum, but we have to take the essential supremum, because if you have here measurable functions, you always can change measurable functions at one point, so this shouldn't play a role. So this means the essential supremum of a function is the smallest upper bound, so that maybe the function is bigger than this guy, but where it is bigger is a null set. So I mean, it's always, we can change things on a null set. So for measurable functions, we should not take the supremum, because this doesn't make sense, because this is really pointwise defined, but we should take the supremum modulo a null set. And this is what we call the essential supremum. But then again, we should not look, so we take the essential supremum over all lambdas in R, but we only should look at positions where the E really puts mass. So this means what we really should take is that lambda should not be arbitrary here, but should be restricted to the support of my measure. And so the support is the smallest closed set such that outside of this support, E has no mass, so E outside there is equal to zero. So maybe the support here, that is the smallest closed set C, of course subset of R. I mean, the measure lives on R. It takes on values which are operators, but it is defined on R. And so I'm taking here the smallest closed set C in R, such that outside this set, the E is equal to zero. So this is like the support of an ordinary measure on R. The support is where really the measure lives. So mu of the support, let's say we have a probability measure, mu of the support is equal to 1. And outside, if I take E of a set which is outside of the support, it is zero. That are the sets which this measure doesn't see. And of course, we have here also measures which depend on our operators. Maybe some of them see all of R, but some of them only see smaller parts of R. Okay, and this is this guy. And now the question is, what is the support? So what do they really see, and what does this have to do with the operator? And that's where the spectrum now really comes into the game, shows up. And so namely for this, we should now see how this here relates with our definition of the spectrum, because for the spectrum, to define the spectrum, we looked at very specific functions of our operators. So namely, the spectrum are those lambda for which T minus lambda is not defined, has no inverse. Or the other way around, the resolvent set are those lambdas for which T minus lambda inverse makes sense as a bounded operator. Okay, but now we have a way with our spectral theorem of writing any function as an integral over our spectral resolution, which means we can relate the functions which we have in the definition of the resolvent with this calculus here. So let us see what we get for this. So let us take as a function f the function lambda minus lambda 0 to the minus 1 for fixed lambda 0 in R. And then if I'm now looking on the corresponding integral with respect for this function, then of course I get exactly what I have to look at if I have to decide whether lambda 0 is in the spectrum or not. So if we have this, then the function t minus lambda 0 to the minus 1 must be the same as integrating the function 1 minus 1 over lambda minus lambda 0 dE lambda. Our spectral calculus tells us that if I'm integrating this function here with respect to this, I get a function of my operator, and of course this function behaves in all algebraic respects as it should behave, so it must be this operator. Okay, and so according to what I said, I can now relate the norm of this operator, the operator norm, somehow with the property of this function. Okay, and of course, the operator norm of this quantity is more or less the question whether this operator exists as a bounded operator. If it exists, then lambda 0 is in the resolvent set. If not, then I am in the spectrum. According to what we said there, the norm of this t minus lambda 0 to the minus 1 should be the essential supremum of this function 1 over lambda minus lambda 0, where I'm taking lambda from the support of E. And at the moment, I still don't know what the support of E is. The part of what I'm doing here is really to try to get an understanding what is the support of E. Where does this E really put its main mass to? From this we now see that this operator norm here, we know now that this is finite or infinite depending on whether lambda 0 is in the spectrum or not. This quantity here, this side here is equal. Maybe I write it here on this side. So this is equal either to a finite number or it is equal to infinity. Finite number means this is a bounded operator, and this means the lambda 0 is in the resolvent set. So if lambda 0 is in the resolvent of my operator, the resolvent set, and this is an unbounded operator, if I'm in the spectrum. If lambda 0 is in the spectrum of T. But this now tells me something about this, namely the supremum over this function here, if I'm running over the support of E, should be finite or infinite according to whether lambda 0 is in the resolvent set or not. And of course, this function here at lambda 0 goes to infinity. The essential supremum of this around lambda 0 goes to infinity. So this thing here is infinity if I am allowed to run in this supremum here over lambdas, which are close as I want to lambda 0. So this means, this tells me essentially, or exactly, that the support of E should be really the spectrum. Because then, if lambda is in the spectrum, then this guy here goes to infinity, but if lambda is in the resolvent set, then this is not. So this tells me, so what I want to get something about the support of E from this. So this tells me the support of E is equal to the spectrum of T. Because then, yeah, if I'm in the spectrum, then I can run over lambdas, which are also in the spectrum, and then this guy explodes, and then I get norm infinity. And if I'm not in the spectrum, then I'm claiming here the support of E is not there, then I'm not allowed to take lambda close to lambda zero, which means this guy here stays bounded if I'm only running over over lambdas which stay away from lambda zero. Good. Okay. So the message of this, what I want to say with this, I'm not sure whether I really said it very clearly, but I hope it's the message at least is clear that from this, because we can control the norm of our functions by the essential supremum of the functions over which we integrate, and we have to see whether this is infinity or not, that this gives us the information whether we whether we are in the spectrum or not. Okay, so maybe again not totally clear, but okay, the message is the supremum of E is the spectrum of T. So I mean, a priori, I have a spectral decomposition of my operator. I just get a resolution of the identity, which puts mass, and mass, of course, are now operators. So at the empty set, it's zero. Then it goes to for the whole set, it goes to identity. In between, it goes between zero and identity, and it puts mass on some sets. And it doesn't put mass on other sets, and this here tells us it really lives on the spectrum. And so in particular, this means if I'm integrating my measurable functions, the only action really happens on the spectrum, which means the measurable function which I'm integrating, I don't have to know it outside the spectrum, but it's enough to have a measurable function on the spectrum. So this is what I really want to say. What is the consequence of all this? Maybe let me give a bit more space and write it down here, because that's maybe the most important point of all this. So the support of my projection valued measure is not all of R, but the spectrum. Of course, in special cases, it can be all of R if the spectrum is everything. But for a fixed operator, it's just the spectrum. So let me write it again. The support of my projection valued measure is the spectrum of T. And this means that if I'm integrating a function f with respect to this measure, then actually, effectively, I'm only integrating over the spectrum for this function. Because this guy here only puts mass on the spectrum. So outside, the increments are all zero and nothing happens. Yeah, and this means, in particular, that the f only has to be defined on the spectrum. So actually what I have here is a measurable functional calculus for all functions, for all measurable functions which are on the spectrum. So not for functions which are defined everywhere, but the functions only have to be defined on the spectrum. So f only needs to be defined on the spectrum of T. So f is a measurable function from the spectrum of T to C. And maybe usually we are interested in taking functions for which we also get a self-adjoint operator, and then of course it should go to R. So every function from the spectrum of T to the reals gives us a self-adjoint operator. So f of t is then a self-adjoint operator.